Hello dear students, actually there are few things which are always important for Olympiad or even JEE Advanced. So time to time I bring such kind of things for you for your better understanding of the physical and inorganic chemistry. So today I am going to talk about it, the Clapeyron equation, which has been quite important for the phase transformation. So write the heading, Clapeyron equation. For phase change or phase transformation, so this is we are talking about the Clapeyron equation for phase change or phase transformation. Phase transformation, you understand, phase is the part of the material which has the uniform composition and uniform properties throughout. Physical state and phase could be same, but in one particular physical state, a particular substance may have more than one phase. And like that, you know many of the examples of it, like carbon solid. You know the crystalline form of the carbon solid, graphite and diamond. These two have the different density, different bonding behavior. And these are the two different phases of the solid carbon. Similarly, you have sulfur, sulfur rhombic, sulfur monoclinic. So these are two solid different phases of the sulfur, solid sulfur. Like that you have the phosphorus, red phosphorus, black phosphorus, white phosphorus, all these are phases. Of course, solid water, that means ice, ice and liquid water, they are also two different phases, of course, two different phases and two different physical states also. So two different physical states of the substance are of course two different phases, but in the particular physical state also you may have the two or more phases, as I took the examples of the solid carbon, solid sulfur and solid phosphorus. So this Clapeyron equation is all about the variation of the pressure, width, temperature at equilibrium state for the phase change. So let us talk about the phase change. For example, A is one phase and this is B. This is phase transformation. This is phase transformation. So at a particular temperature and pressure, of course, some equilibrium will be there in that between the two phases. So at equilibrium state, you will say that the Gibbs function for A is GA and the Gibbs function for B is GB. At equilibrium, you know very well, delta GR is equal to 0. That means GA is equal to GB. If at all you change the temperature and pressure a little bit, for example, you make the temperature T plus DT and the pressure is varied to P plus DP. Of course, when you change the temperature or pressure slightly, G also will change. For a given substance, if you change the pressure and temperature, G value also change and you know the variation. For a substance in thermodynamics, there is a vital formula, there is a famous formula, what? dG is equal to VdP minus sdT. You remember this formula? This is quite a famous formula in thermodynamics. Second law of thermodynamics, when we talk about the Gibbs function, there we write dG is equal to VdP minus sdT. Of course, when temperature is changed from T to D plus dT, pressure is changed from P plus dP, then G value will change. And now GA dash would be equal to what? The initial value plus the change. What change? Volume of the A and dP minus entropy of A into dT. So this is the value of a Gibbs function of A now, when the pressure and temperature are changed by a little value. Similarly, G function or G value or Gibbs free energy for the B also will change, and say this becomes GB dash. Would be what? The older value, new value of the Gibbs function at the new conditions of the new pressure and temperature would be what? Older value plus the change caused. Change caused is what? V volume of B into dp minus entropy of p into dt. So this is the value. These are the values at new equilibrium. These were the values at equilibrium. At equilibrium again. Of course, equilibrium will be there at some other condition also. If the pressure is changed, temperature is changed, then some other values, equilibrium would be there. Again at equilibrium, delta GR should be zero at equilibrium again. So you would say that GA dash now again would be equal to GB dash. And once you put this value, GA plus VA dP minus SA dT is equal to GB plus VB dP minus SB dT. Of course, GA and GB are cancelled out. Why? Because GA and GB were equal initially. So they are equated. And if you bring this value SB here, so you say SB minus SA is into DT will be equal to, or you can say like this, VB minus VA into DP. So from here you get DP upon DT is equal to entropy change upon volume change. But you know, this is the entropy change of the phase change. Again, in thermodynamics, we know very well that dP upon dT, we can write entropy change is nothing but enthalpy change of the phase change upon T, transition temperature, into delta V. Let me see in the camera that whether this is not cut at the bottom. Let me check. Nah, it's there. Everything is coming in the screen. So, dP upon dT is equal to delta H of the phase change upon temperature of the transition, of course in Kelvin, into delta V. I can write this in a simple words. Before I wipe it off, just note down everything. Students might have heard of not only the simple Clapeyron equation, Clausius Clapeyron equation is quite famous among the students, and they use this particular equation for the variation of the vapor pressure with respect to the temperature. We'll come to that also. So let us take this. We can write dP upon dT in the simple words. We can say this is delta H of the phase change upon temperature of the phase change into delta V. This equation is known as Clapeyron equation. So guys, this equation is Clapeyron equation for phase change. That means through this calculations can be done. From this equation now we can derive the derivation of Clausius Clapeyron equation. Derivation of Clausius Clapeyron equation. So derivation of Clausius Clapeyron equation, I am removing this particular portion also, you might have noted all that. So this is Clapeyron equation. Now we are talking about the Clausius Clapeyron equation. Clausius Clapeyron equation, particularly variation of vapor pressure of a liquid with temperature. So that we can do. Now we are dealing with the liquid and vapor equilibrium. Liquid is converting into gas, a particular substance. Say this is again phase change. Vaporization. So we are talking about the vaporization here. So in that case, if you take this particular equation, dp upon dt would be what? Delta H of evaporation. This is molar enthalpy of evaporation. We are doing the calculations on the molar basis. That means substance is taken 1 mole. So 1 mole of the liquid is converted into the gas at under equilibrium condition. So temperature T is nothing but, so this is the temperature, and delta V, that means V gas minus V liquid. Of course, you know V liquid is very small in comparison to the gas. So VL is much less than VG. Volume of liquid is much smaller in comparison to that of gas. Gas occupies much larger volume. The same amount of gas will occupy much larger volume than compared to the liquid, volume of liquid. So we can ignore. Of course, VL is much less than VG. So we ignore it. Removed. And we can say dp upon dt would be equal to delta H of vaporization upon temperature. And this is VG. So VG could be written gas volume, PV is equal to nRT. We can write PV is equal to RT for 1 mole. So V is equal to RT upon P. Put this value here. So what value? RT upon P. P comes in the numerator. So dP upon P would be equal to what? Delta H enthalpy of evaporation upon RT square dT. Integrate it now. From T1 to T2, and this is P1 to P2. Of course, P1, P2 are vapor pressure of liquid at temperature T1 and T2. So P1, P2 are the vapor pressure of the liquid at temperature T1 and T2. Of course, enthalpy of evaporation, we will assume it to be constant. For the little variation of the temperature, we are assuming that enthalpy of evaporation is remaining constant, does not change much. So what do we do now? First, you note down everything. I'm going to wipe this upper portion now. So, on integrating this value, ln P2 over P1 would be equal to what? Enthalpy of evaporation delta H evaporation upon R, taking the enthalpy of evaporation to be constant and independent of temperature, minus 1 upon T and limit T1 to T2. See, enthalpy of evaporization is taken constant. That is independent of temperature. So you simplify this equation. So ln P2 over P1 is equal to delta H enthalpy of evaporation upon R 1 upon T1 minus 1 upon T2. So this is the equation, and this is known as Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So in Clapeyron equation, if you take the specific case of conversion of the liquid into vapor or the case of the vaporization, you get the mathematical equation for solving the questions, and that is called as Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So guys, ln P2 over P1 is equal to delta H evaporation upon R 1 upon T1 minus 1 upon T2. Of course, in the log term, you can write for calculations purpose. You mostly use this particular one as log base 10 P2 over P1 is equal to delta H enthalpy of vaporization upon 2.303 R1 upon T1 minus 1 upon T2. Same thing, this is also Clausius Clapeyron equation. The only thing is you have done for the better calculations, for the easier calculations, natural base has been converted to the base 10. So log of P2 over P1 is equal to delta H enthalpy of vaporization upon 2.303 R1 upon T1 minus 1 upon T2. So P2 and P1, yeah, P1, P2 are vapor pressure of liquid at temperature T1 and T2. Guys, this is useful. Olympiads, this is quite useful. NSEC, this is quite useful. Even JEE Advanced, this formula is useful for the calculations of variation of vapor pressure with the variation in temperature. Of course, data will be given in the question of enthalpy of vaporization. So like that, you define it and no one way. This equation can also be used for the boiling point. So these are the external pressure. If P1 and P2 are the external pressures, then T1 and T2 will become what? They will become the boiling point. Alternatively, see, one way of understanding or explaining this Clausius-Clapeyron equation is that if you take the temperature T1 and T2, so P1 and T2 are the vapor pressure, but these vapor pressures, if become equal to the external pressure, then T1 and T2 become the boiling point. Of course, this is the definition of the boiling point. This is the definition of boiling point. What is boiling point? The temperature at which the vapor pressure of the liquid becomes equal to the external pressure. So what do you say here? Alternatively, if P1 and P2 are external pressures, then T1 and T2 are boiling point. Of liquid. So if P1 and P2 are the external pressures, then T1 and T2 are the boiling point of liquids. So that way also it can be interpreted. So let me summarize this entire small lecture for you, just for your better understanding. If you are aiming for the JEE Advanced with a good rank or NSEC exams or further Olympiads, you should know that this dP upon dT is equal to delta V upon delta S upon delta V, or simply you can say delta H upon T into delta V, one and the same thing. This equation is Clapeyron equation. But if it is applied for the liquid to gas conversion, then vaporization process, then you say that ln P2 over P1 is equal to enthalpy of vaporization upon R1 upon T1 minus 1 upon T2. This is Clausius Clapeyron equation. Accordingly, you can use these equations for solving the questions if you understand them. Of course, this is pure thermodynamics. These are the applications of thermodynamics, Gibbs function. Through Gibbs function, you are easily able to calculate the variation of the vapor pressure with respect to the temperature variation for a given liquid, or the variation of the boiling point with respect to the external pressure variation. That is also the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. That's it for now.